is the BBC Life Press. The
top 20. It's the early.
Good evening.
Welcome back to the History of DJ and the Pirate Radio episodes. I had two fantastic years on this ship, Radio Caroline North. But of course, there were many more ships around the ocean and many more tales to tell. So let's get on with it.
Prior to Radio Caroline, there was half an hour of pop music a week. Half an hour a week on British radio. And from half an hour a week, it went suddenly overnight to 24 hours a day. And this was somewhat of a shock for everybody, the government, for us, for the listeners.
The thing about wanting a job or wanting anything, the value of that thing increases dramatically in relation to its scarcity. You know, if there were diamonds everywhere, diamonds would be cheap. And the same is true of jobs in radio. And what choices did we have in the 60s before the pirate ships came along? You had the late programme, the obvious first choice for people like me, and Radio Luxembourg in the evening. But again, these were heroes. These were people that were beyond humanity. These were not mortals. These people had jobs in radio. This is something that you have to know. It's like becoming a Hollywood star. How do you become a Hollywood star? Well, I don't know. For someone who became a Hollywood star, it must have seemed easy. But you cannot just switch this on, pick up the phone call, say, I want this job. There were no jobs, and the chances of getting one on the BBC or Radio Luxembourg were pretty remote. There were six jobs on Radio Luxembourg, and they were all well spoken for. So along comes the chance to do that, pirate radio ships. And suddenly, the doors are opened an inch or two, you know, and people who don't have very much experience are practically welcomed. You know, yeah, what can you do? Step on, let's see what you can. Send us a tape in. Well, that's rubbish. I'm sure you'll sort it out when you get out there. You know, and pretty much that's how most of us got our job. I should think we started our careers by mimicking everything we'd ever heard, probably on the light. So we were all Alan Freeman for a while, I should think. Whoever was broadcasting at the time, Pete Murray, we would all of those people that we'd heard, that was the only reference that we had. And so I found myself, probably like others, mimicking, imitating, to try and find a style until I don't know whether I ever did find a particular style, but eventually that's how all of us became the personalities we did, standing on the shoulders of giants.
Oh, we love the pirate stations. We love the pirate stations.
Listen, we're having a great time here in Zurich, and as you know and you've heard, if you've been listening for any length of time at all, it is an international sort of radio festival, and our section of it very much concerns the 60s and the heady days of pirate radio. You've heard of Radio Caroline, Radio Naughty International, Radio London, and all that. Not many people, it would appear, have heard of Radio 270. This is a ship that was up there in the off the northeast coast, and that's the ship that I was on. Mark Wesley was on it too.
The most unusual thing about Radio 270 as a pirate radio station was occasionally it needed refueling. It was the only pirate radio ship that stopped transmitting and chugged into the harbour and refueled actually in the harbour.
With all the lights out.
All the lights out, yeah. And the local Bobby would turn up with his bicycle and have a cup of tea in the galley. And then we, because the chef, so he called it the Cordon Bleu chef, who couldn't cook breakfast. So whenever we were on in Bridlington Harbour, the DJs would go to the nearest cafe, Greasy Spoon, to get us some decent food. And then you'd hear the hooter, beep, beep. We knew the ship was on its way. So we had to rush out of the Greasy Spoon onto the boat, and the boat would chug out. There it is.
Thank you, Mark. Couldn't stop him once he started. Good night.
I'd hardly left the harbour when it suddenly became very apparent that I was not a good sailor. And I was violently ill, as I say, just as we came out of the harbour. So it did cross my mind to think, had I made a wise decision?
Thank you very much, Julian. I hope you're going to feel better very soon. The boat is sort of rocking away in a sort of a very slow but annoying way, and Julian isn't feeling too well. Anyway, hope you feel better.
Radio 270
was a converted deep sea trawler with the standard sort of 170 feet of tubular aluminium up top. And what they'd done it on the cheap. There used to be a racing yacht called Scepter. And they took a spare mast from Scepter and welded it onto another bit of mast, so it had a huge welded join in the middle. What we discovered was they'd welded down all the fish hatches, where they used to shovel the fish down into the holds, which were the boat, the living quarters and the studios and everything were down below. So there was only one way out for about a dozen people. I looked up, it was very rough, it was blowing like blazes. And the mast snapped in the middle, and the top half of the mast lifted up in the air, swung over and went down over the side. So it was like having a huge weight anchor on one side of the ship. So the whole ship went straight over on its side. There was a scary period for a couple of hours while we thought we were going to sink. I was all right, I was on deck. The other guys were down below and they couldn't get out. And we cut the rigging, there were three of us, it was like something out of a movie. You know, we cut the rigging loose with fire axes and dropped the mast over the side to the bottom of the sea. And then got blamed later for not putting a marker buoy down because it was aluminium, it was very expensive. We weren't actually thinking too much about putting a marker buoy down, we were thinking about getting the ship upright.
I suppose the rough weather was our greatest problem because, there was a fair amount of it.
We could get terrible. I mean, we were out there, I remember one day in a force 9 gale. Every other disc jockey on the station was sick.
The atmosphere on the boat was just incredible all the time because we're dealing with 18, 19 year olds. I was only 20, 21 myself at the time, and you're dealing with kids that think they'll live forever, oblivious to the danger, and just enjoying the excitement of, you know, playing records, being a disc jockey, and having fun.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to take us about an hour and we're going to go out and see Radio 270.
The boats from here used to run, you know, excursions out to see the boat. A new Georgie girl. Of course, it was good for the local tourists and bringing people to the town because they used to go on the boats, as you know, the Corona, and sail round it, and it was a trip in a trip there.
Off Scarborough, we used to have a trail of pleasure boats coming round, circling us. They used to shout at us. The girls used to throw us packets of crisps and things. Oh, yeah, I mean, the outpouring of public affection was enormous.
What came over, and I've listened to many, many tapes, and I remember it from listening to it live, that the fun that came out of that transistor radio was incredible.
Oh, we love the pirate station.
My first experience on radio was on a fort, an old naval fort in the estuary, Thames estuary. I was 17 at the time, and I was given the job by the guy that started it, a guy called Roy Bates.
Out of Leon Sea, a boat is made ready to leave with supplies for one of the pirate era's smallest radio stations. So small is this operation that the managing director, Roy Bates, unable to afford the staff, took on the job himself of loading the tender, which to us on board the old wartime fort 12 miles away was our only lifeline and tenuous link with civilization. I suppose in reality, Radio Essex was Britain's first local radio station. While it could be said that there wasn't the money to finance the large transmitter to compete with the other semi-national stations, Roy Bates' idea of chasing local advertisers for sponsorship was fairly unique at the time. And the time I'm talking about started on November the 1st, 1965, and continued till Christmas Day, 1966. the station forced to close after final proof of our immovable transmitter site being inside territorial waters was submitted to a court of law. Our nearest neighbours, Radio City, you can just make them out. And it's Radio 390 in the furthest distance.
Roy already had in mind the Knock John's Tower, which is where Radio Essex was eventually based. And he decided a week or so later to go out to this fort and claim it, sit on it and claim it, which is what they tried to do initially.
We went out to the fort, which had, by the way, been taken over by Radio City guys. They'd put a generator on there and a transmitter. Batesy went on there first of all with some other guys, turfed them off, sent them back to Radio City. We're left with the equipment, need to babysit the fort in case they come back. You had Roy Bates, who wasn't actually a gangster, although he was given that reputation, more of a pirate, I think, you know, in a swashbuckling way than almost anybody else was.
Bates claims his station is now running third in Essex to London and 390, and is optimistic about prospects.
Do you think there is a vast untapped advertiser's revenue waiting? I mean, is there...
Oh, yes.
I mean, have you got a licence to print your own banknotes for a station like this?
No, it's not as easy as that. But every day, every week, every month, more and more business people and more businesses are becoming educated to use commercial radio.
He was an ex-captain in the army. And he had the sword cut down the side of his cheek. He looked like a guy that could take care of him. He's a big, barrel-chested guy. And you couldn't help but be motivated by him. Wonderful character. And on the other hand, Radio City was run by a music business chap called Reg Calvert.
We were going to the Rough Towers Fort with a view to recovering certain property valued over £1,000. Belonging to us. We got there, it still appeared abandoned. We shouted and got no replies. We started to make efforts to get somebody onto the ladder, which was already hanging down, a rope ladder. We got one man on, when suddenly over the top, a number of heavy gas cylinders were thrown at us. A half a dozen Molotov cocktails, glass bottles with petrol or paraffin in, which were alight. They smashed onto the tender. We had to back away. The man was left on the ladder. We returned to try and rescue him. We were attacked again and again, making the rescue impossible.
What were they trying to do?
They were apparently occupying the fort and they were determined to stop us coming up. In fact, without any doubt, it was an attempt to seriously injure us and the boat.
Why are they occupying the fort?
They want to stop us occupying it.
Took us for Radio City and carried a photographer hot on the trail after the news that Reg Calvert, owner of Radio City, had been shot.
Some kind of deal was being done between Radio City and Radio London. It involved providing City with a better transmitter. But somehow or other, the cost of that was not paid back to London. That's where it is. I'm trying to think what Smedley's involvement was and why he was so offended by this that it came to such an extent that he ended up shooting Calvert.
Dateline, Wednesday, June the 22nd, Essex. William Oliver Smedley has been charged with the murder of Reg Calvert, the head of Radio City, who was found dead in a house in Saffron Walden this morning. Smedley was remanded in custody for a fortnight. Mr. Calvert died from a gunshot wound in the chest.
We live under the rule of law in this country, and these people are acting quite illegally. And it's no good complaining about lawlessness in our towns and cities if they can cock a snook at the law on the seas round our shores. And how will the bill achieve your object?
Well, the bill is aimed at doing this without violence, of course, without boarding parties and gunboats and this sort of thing. The offence, the broadcasting itself is an offence, will become an offence, but it also becomes an offence to either place advertising with the pirate ships or to supply them with records or equipment or food or anything of that kind.
It was the happenings surrounding Radio City in June 1966 that were to do the offshore broadcasters no good at all. These events over the next few days would prove to be the death knell for the offshore stations.
In commander's style, the raiders boarded Radio City early last Monday morning, round about 3 a.m. But news of the raid only filtered back to land yesterday. All lines of communication from Radio City had been effectively cut as a precaution. But the line of operation, the real thing proper, started last Sunday afternoon when a man, as yet unidentified, went to a Gravesend shipyard and told the skippers there that he wanted to hire a tug. He said he and his friends were going on a mystery tour. Well, the mystery tour ended here, Radio City, 12 miles out in the Thames estuary from Whitstable. At 3 a.m., just a few hours after the last pop record had been played and the station had closed down for the night, a boarding party moored up its tug alongside these 30-foot-high concrete pillars and then clambered up using grappling irons. Then they held hostage the three disc jockeys aboard and the seven recording gear. And it seems that they're still here. As you can see at the top there, getting ready to lower the lift to take on supplies, are members of the party, the raiding party. It looks as if they have every intention of staying there. Radio City, where the government has failed, has for the time being at least been effectively silenced.
Radio London had plans to take over Radio City's Shivering Sands Fort and broadcast UKGM, a sweet music station. But the following day, Radio City's boss, Reg Calvert, is shot dead.
It was the excuse that Tony Benn needed. I mean, he couldn't make his argument stick about stolen frequencies or the damage it was doing.
The pirate radio ships have no future at all. I'm quite convinced of that. And I think the sooner they're convinced of it, the better.
The truth of the matter, Benn, Anthony Wedgwood Benn, didn't like the idea of other people having control of broadcasting. He saw it as a government, you know, responsibility. How could you possibly allow people to have transmitters? And my God, they'll actually start saying things they think about that come out of the mouth without scripting it. You know, radio might become spontaneous, which of course the one thing at that time, the light program, was not spontaneous. Even the pop programs that were running were all scripted, and it was the only way they knew how to do it. So I suspect there was a very strong political motivation to take it out of the hands of freelancers and privateers.
The Rough Sands Tower off Harwich. That was very nearly the new base that Radio Essex was going to broadcast from. Our plans were thwarted by hunger. After a couple of weeks waiting for Bates to return with supplies, we ran out of food and had to call upon the services of the local lifeboat, leaving behind all the equipment, which was immediately claimed by a crew from Radio Caroline, who were put aboard as soon as news of our rescue reached them. Not a very noble end for Radio Essex, but the end of an exciting and unusual time for a 17-year-old boy who wanted to go into radio.
Come the 60s. If you couldn't get a ship with a transmitter on, you could jump on board one of these forts, and that's what Screaming Lord Sutch did when he launched his pirate radio station.
I'm putting up all the finance for this.
How much?
Well, it exceeds $5,000 at the overhaul cost. We haven't actually spent this amount yet, but this will cost at least.
And how long do you think that sort of money will keep you going?
Well, until we get some more financial backing, but we don't intend taking on any cheap commercials, cigarettes or pop or anything like this.
Well now, you lucky people, if you'd like a request on Radio Sutch, then write to Radio Sutch, King's Agency, number 7 Denmark Street, London, WC2.
That was Little Richard singing Annie's Back in her brand new Cadillac.
In September 1965, Rich Calford buys Radio Sutch, changing the name to Radio City.
On 197 metres medium wave, this is the station that was created by Screaming Lord Sutch.
My progress in radio was you know, in stages that improved in terms of the ship and the radio station and the professionalism of the operation. So I went for Radio Essex, which was amateur hour.
Hang on, David, Bert Bacharach composition this. I smiled yesterday.
But without it, I'd have got nowhere.
So I smiled yesterday.
So I'm immensely grateful and wouldn't have changed it for the world to Radio 270, which is where I met Paul Burnett, by the way. I think I replaced Paul Burnett. I met him as he left the ship.
Hello, it's Paul Burnett on the swinging boat off the northeast coast. Radio 270, the station with a smile.
And we sort of shook hands and we changed places. He went off to the Isle of Man for Manx Radio, and I was doing his job on Radio 270, which was fun. But I knew that there were better stations around, and Radio Scotland was doing quite well, so I thought, well, I'll have a crack at that. And they gave me a job, and I stayed on Radio Scotland until the whole pirate scene was closed down in August 1968.
Sony Radio Awards for both Broadcaster of the Year, Programmer of the Year, Fellow of the Radio Academy, the IMF British Music Roll of Honour for outstanding contributions to British music, and voted the most influential person in the music industry by radio and record executives. You must be getting into a right big head by now.
Do you know, it's always nice to receive awards from your peers. You know, I think that's very, very special. And it's been nice to have had that happened on a couple of times over what's now actually a fairly large number of years.
Let's go back all those years now, Richard. Let's talk about Richard as a youngster in Fife. What was life like for you as a kid?
Life in Fife as a kid was good for me. I had a lot of good friends that are still my friends to this day, so I've kept with the same circle of people. Of course, when I told them I was off to be a DJ on a pirate ship, they all thought I was stone mad. Because I'd started in a different profession, you see. I'd gone into journalism when I was 16 years of age. Left school straight away because I knew there was a job I could get on my local paper. And so I took that on. At the same time, the pirates were starting up, and I was mad for the music. So people always think it was because I loved the sound of my own voice that I became a DJ, but actually it wasn't. I just loved those songs, and I could, and literally have almost ever since, listened to them all day long. So I was quickly through the newspaper situation. I had 2 years doing that, and then when I got a chance to get onto Radio Scotland, I took it with both hands.
Tell me how that chance came along and why you felt you could be a DJ. Did you go through auditions? Did you practice? What was going on there?
Do you know, I never practiced in my life because my journalistic job, I would be doing reports on the county council activities. I'd go to the sheriff court every day and we were doing a variety of horrendous reports on court cases, etc. At night, I'd be out covering local county councils. And although at the weekends I'd go out to my ballroom and listen to the tunes, and you know, bands would still be playing in those days, and the DJs only came on actually for about 10 minutes. I mean, I knew what I wanted to do. And I heard DJs in dance halls, and I thought, actually, that's who I want to be. I suppose, though, truthfully, I'd got into radio. I was at a boarding school, and I'd got into radio there. I remember being taken to the sick bay as a very young man, and there was a radio in there, and I turned it on, and there was a play on. I think that's what hooked me first of all. And then I realized there was all these music programs as well. And Jailhouse Rock was a big hit at this time. And I remember that absolutely mesmerizing me.
One threw a party in the county jail. The prison band was there and they began to wail. The band was jumping and the joint began to swing. You should have heard those knocked out jailbirds sing, let it rock. Everybody let it rock.
And so when the school holidays came, I was down in the local cafe to hear that all in the jukebox. I think something that inspired me really in a funny sort of way was not to have the music available all the time, because in a boarding school there are times when you have to be working, you have to be playing sport, you have to be in the refectory for your meal or whatever it might be. It wasn't like when you live at home and it's accessible all the time. And so I was on a bit of a starvation diet, and that made me all the hungrier for it, you know, because we weren't allowed radios in the dormitories there. There's no under the bedclothes club for us. My parents were pretty surprised when I told them I was going to go for this interview, because there'd been an advert in one of the Scottish national papers. Broadcasters wanted to apply to Radio Scotland, the pirate ship. So I thought, I've got to have a go for this. So I duly sent off a letter, and I got a letter back. I mean, these days, pinged an email across and back, but in those days, a letter took a sort of a week, 2 weeks to work both ways. And I got a letter back asking me to come to an audition. And when I went into the on-land base of Radio Scotland, there was 55 people waiting for an afternoon's audition. I thought, well, I'll never get this. I've wasted my time coming all this way. But believe it or not, I got the job out of all those people. And I thought that day I was the luckiest person on earth. 2 weeks later, as I sat in a force 10 gale off the Firth of Clyde, I thought differently.
On 2 foot 2 meters in the medium wave band, this is Radio Scotland. The disc jockeys on board the ship worked a shift system where they were on board for several weeks. On board there, you can see Mel Howard. And a very youthful Richard Park, complete with sideburns and glasses. Let's go downstairs to the studio where Tony Allen is just about to start another program.
Hi, hello, and welcome from me, Tony Allen. Might be more familiar to any of you as the mighty...
In those days, cartridges weren't used for commercials and station identifications. Everything was on reel-to-reel tape. The studio used Garrett 301 turntables and ferrograph tape recorders by and large. Tony Allen was just one of the many disc jockeys who sat in that little studio and broadcast to the people not only of Scotland, but Northern Ireland and the north of England and the Isle of Man as well.
I warn anybody that goes to work for a Scottish radio station is that you've got to learn to pronounce the names of some of these people and some of their towns.
Kirkwood Brightshire, for example.
Oh, I can't begin to tell you. I have a classic example of exactly what I mean here. I read out one that was to Mr. and Mrs. McTavish of Souchy Hall Street. I had no idea where Souchy Hall Street was. And lots of complaints came in, and from then onwards, the captain had to sit next to me to give me the pronunciations. What do you expect? What chance did I have?
We meet the man who set up Radio Scotland, the man whose dream the station was, Tommy Shields. Sadly, Tommy never recovered from the upset of losing his radio station and died of a broken heart 6 months after the station went off.
To the nation. This is Caroline Newsweek.
Good evening, everybody. This is Graham Webb with the news that I have just scribed from the BBC bulletin 10 minutes ago.
That's right. Put your job there on that. Swiping the news. Did you swipe the news?
I swiped the news on the odd occasion.
Very shortly, the actual wedding on board Radio Caroline North on Tuesday, September 20, in 1966. A wedding between one of our disc jockeys, Mick Luvzit from Canada, and Jan Teret. That's all happening shortly, but in the meantime...
Caroline! Time on Radio Caroline North, your Cupid station, exactly 5 o'clock.
Newsbeat. Bringing news information. This is Radio Caroline Newsbeat, fast and factual.
Commercial radio broadcasting history will be made this afternoon when Caroline North disc jockey Mick Luvzit marries Miss Janet Teret in a ceremony to be broadcast from the lounge of the MV Caroline.
The day of the wedding was fantastic because we got all these guests on the Isle of Man ready to come out on the tender and all these boats which we got ready to make it a big occasion with pop stars. We had the Mersey Beats, we had the Crying Shames, all kinds of groups waiting to come out. And they couldn't find us because it was foggy. And we had the fog horn going and we're all on deck looking for boats and things to try and find these guests. Well, it finally happened and Mick Luvzit and Jan Luvzit became a Luvzit duo.
News, Scotland.
Flash. We interrupt this program to bring you a Caroline Newsbeat News Flash.
And the bride has arrived. The bride, Miss Janet Teret, has arrived here on MV Caroline. The wedding between Mick Luvzit and Miss Janet Teret will take place in approximately 10 to 15 minutes from now.
You see this guy? This guy's in love with you.
I, Martin Hips, captain of the Panamanian merchant vessel, MV Caroline, in the name of the Republic and by the authority vested in me, by the laws of Panama, now pronounce you man and wife.
I can't tell, we know each other very well. How can I show you? I'm glad I got to know you, 'cause I need your love. I want your love.
Wedding bells for Mick and Jan. Congratulations from everybody on Radio Caroline.
This has been Caroline Newsbeat.
I think what we better do, honey, is turn on the wireless set.
Oh, and this is that bloke Mick craves it, isn't it?
No, no, Wilbert. Mick Luvzit, Luvzit.
Mick Luvzit had an alter ego. And you just heard her then. That was Granny.
You've Thomas. All wondered about this. It's true. Mick's gay.
And what does Granny have to say about that?
That's a Luvzit lip lock.
Oh, yes.
It's 3 o'clock, full of a watch time. B-U-L-O-V-A, when you know what...
Makes a watch tick.
Makes a watch tick. You'll buy a boulevard!
Sounds like a lot of boulevard to me.